Okay. Good evening and welcome to our September 4th meeting. I'd like to announce two exits, one at the front, one at the rear. If we could all stand for the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First order of business, address the minutes. I need a motion addressing the minutes of August 7th.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion, changes, comments? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried. I didn't.
Yes, we did.
No, I didn't.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that was just the 7th.
I did them separate. Yep. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Second approval in a minute for the August 21st meeting. I need a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Any discussions, questions? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried. Okay, first order of business is a authorization to accept the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update for Orange County, New York. Whereas the Orange County Department of Emergency Services, with the assistance from Barton and Logidis, DPC, has gathered information and prepared the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update for Orange County, New York. And whereas the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update for Orange County, New York has been prepared in accordance with the Disaster Mitigation Act of 2000 and Title 44 Code of Federal Regulations, CFR Part 201, and whereas Title 44 CFR Chapter 1, Part 201.6, Sub C, Number 5, requires each local government participating in the preparation of the multi-jurisdictional mitigation plan or plan update to accept and adopt such plan. And whereas the Village of Monroe has reviewed the 2016 multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update for Orange County, has found the document to be acceptable, and as a local unit of government has afforded its citizens an opportunity to comment and provide input regarding the plan update and the actions included in the plan. Whereas the Village of Monroe will consider the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan for Orange County during the implementation and updating of local planning mechanisms and will incorporate the hazard assessment data, hazard vulnerabilities, and mitigation actions in these mechanisms where applicable. Now, therefore, be resolved that the Village of Monroe, as a participating jurisdiction, adopts the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update for Orange County, New York, dated today, yeah?
This is when the plan was originally created, and in Jim's memo to the board, he explains that it is current plan as it took over 2 years to complete, which is why it has the May 2016 date on it, because that's when it started. And it's already out of date. We have to adopt it as is, and we start the process over of making.
So just May 1, 2000, it doesn't say that, but.
This is how it came from Kristen O'Donnell.
Okay.
So,
okay, May 2016. Okay.
I'll make the motion that we accept the multi-jurisdictional hazard mitigation plan update.
I'll second.
Any further discussion or questions? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye. So carried. Thank you. What I'd like to do, because of time constraints, I'd like to go out of order if I could. And if you go to new business under G, the bond resolution for water system improvements, we have tonight with us Mary Beth Gianconi and our supervisor for the water department, Ernie Mabee. So if we could maybe address what we're going to do tonight, that'd be awesome.
Do I need to talk to the microphone?
If you'd like, whatever's comfortable for you.
So we continue to look at capital plans, we continue to look at the needs of the system. So we've talked about these needs for some time, been here discussing these things with the board over a period of time. And one of the things that has happened recently is that there's a grant opportunity that the village has that we've decided to pursue. We're not committing ourselves to doing this, but if we don't apply, sort of like the lottery, you don't buy a ticket, you can't win. So we are looking to apply for grant funding. The village is not committed to do anything, but if we were able to receive this grant funding through something called the Water Infrastructure Improvement Act 2017, we would receive up to $3 million or 60% of the project cost. That money comes not as a bag of money, that would be really nice, but what it really is its principal forgiveness, meaning you would borrow money one way or another to pay for the improvements, and then when you went to close on a bond, on a bond, on borrowing, you would pay that much less because you would have received this grant. And that directly reduces user cost, which is the objective. So this grant application is due on Friday. Timing is good that we have this meeting this evening. We do have a number of things that we need to do to be able to apply for this grant. We've been working with Catherine and the village clerk and others here in Ernie to gather the information. And the village board has a packet in front of them that has four documents. The first one on the top is a seeker long form state environmental quality review long form assessment. Back at the July meeting, the village board reviewed part one and adopted a resolution of intent to act as lead agency. We then circulated that material to the involved agencies to get their concurrence, and we do have their concurrence that the village board can act as lead agency. So tonight, our first action will be to briefly review this document and make a determination of significance regarding the potential environmental impact of the project, which is, as I just outlined, repairs and replacements to existing infrastructure. We also have a bond resolution on the agenda for this evening. The bond resolution is a requirement of the funding. We have to demonstrate, because again, the money that comes to us is principal forgiveness. It's money at the back end. So we have to have a demonstration that we have the ability to construct the project with our own funds up front if we are to be successful with the grant. Does not commit the village to spend a dime. It's a lots of sheets of paper that say that you could do so. That resolution also authorizes the mayor and clerk to execute documents related to this potential opportunity. So the last two pieces of information you have are the actual grant application, which is the one that looks like this, and the last one is a financing application, and that would be an attempt to seek low-cost borrowing for the balance of the project that wouldn't be funded by a grant. We've also prepared an engineering report, which I will get you a copy. It's a little too big to print. Get you a copy of that outlines the improvements that I just discussed and meets the grant criteria. In addition to that, we have coordinated with the State Historic Preservation Office. They are fine with an application for grant for this project. For the water transmission line, depending on what happens there, we may need to do a cultural resources study down the road. That's okay. And we also have, I don't remember what our last component is, but we have all the parts that we need to do this. So this evening, if we would like to, what we can do is we can look at this environmental assessment. At the last meeting, which I was not here for, but I understand the board reviewed part one, which takes you through page 13 of the document in front of you. And essentially what that is it's a description of the project. And it characterizes the potential impacts to the environment from a project of this nature. Again, what we're really doing here is we're addressing existing infrastructure. So from an environmental impact perspective, we may do some digging, there may be some stormwater we need to deal with, those kinds of things, but we're not, don't have a project that brings with it a lot of environmental impact. What I've done for the board is gone through part two, which is that second chunk that starts on page 1 of 10, and I've looked at the project relative to these areas of assessment that the state asks that we look at in terms of impact on land. We're talking about building something, so we would have an impact. Although when we look at these criteria regarding depth of water,
would be small or no impact and could be mitigated through the design of the project. There are no important geological features in our area, so that's convenient. Impacts on surface water. This project, if we were to repair or replace the transmission line, there is a wetland in that area, so we would have a small and potential impact on that wetland, and in the future, we will have to go through a permitting process with respect to that wetland. Groundwater, we're not doing anything with groundwater. Everything's staying exactly like it is. None of the project is being constructed in a floodway or a floodplain, and we're not going to alter the flow of water over the surface, and we're not going to cause any flooding. The project doesn't involve any impacts on air pollution. It's a water system. So we're fortunate there. Plants and animals, again, because we're repairing and replacing existing infrastructure, we don't see that there would be any impact on plants and animals. And agricultural resources, we're not in where we're looking at doing these things, like in your roads where we're replacing water lines. It's not an agricultural area. Aesthetic resources, nothing that we would be building would be above the ground. It's all pipes underneath the ground, or it would be equipment inside existing equipment shelters that you have at your pump stations. So there's no change in the way things will look. We may potentially have an impact on historical cultural resources, depending on what is ultimately determined to do with the transmission line. But again, we have a sign off from the state that says as long as we study those impacts before we do anything, we mitigate them, we are okay to apply for the grant. The areas that we're talking about are all either private or public property. They're not used for open space and recreation, so we're not going to have any negative impacts on those areas. We are not in a critical environmental area, so we do not have any impacts on that. We're not talking about doing anything that would increase traffic or change any transportation or anything along those lines. And we're not talking about any impacts on energy with respect to this project. Noise, light, and odor, same thing. These are water lines and things within the water system that wouldn't have an impact from that perspective. Human health, I would argue we could say yes, and it would be a positive impact because we're making our water system more robust, and that's always a good thing. They don't give you a yes option, so we say no. They don't give you a yes positive option, so we just say no. Consistency with community plans, you know, clearly you have a water system. You've had it for many, many years. It's part of your community, so it's certainly consistent in that way. And community character. Again, you have a water system. We're not intending to build anything that would change the character of your community. So what I've done on that basis is filled out part three, and I'll just read the statement. And what they're asking you for is an assessment. Identify the impacts from part two, which is what we just went through, and describe their magnitude. That would be size, severity, and extent. Assess the importance of those impacts. Take into consideration anything that you could do to design the project to minimize those impacts. And you are intended to go through each one of those areas where you may have chopped yes and evaluate those situations. And what I've put here is that the replacement of the out-of-service raw water transmission line that serves the Village of Monroe water system will result in a physical disturbance that could result in small or moderate impacts in terms of erosion and sedimentation, dewatering or blasting, wetland buffer area impacts, and possibly impacts to important cultural resources. These small or moderate potential impacts will be mitigated to reduce or eliminate impacts through preparation and implementation of a stormwater pollution prevention plan. Wetland disturbance permitting and mitigation is required. Dewatering and blasting plans, if needed, and documentation of avoidance of culturally important artifacts as required by the State Historic Preservation Office. In these ways, small or moderate impacts that have been identified will be reduced or eliminated to the extent practical. The replacement of the existing distribution and service lines, as well as pumps and controls at booster stations, will have no impact on the environment, as these are replacement in kind or upgrade of existing facilities. So what this document, this last document, is asking you to do is determine if the project as proposed has the potential to have a significant environmental impact. If it would, we would need to do additional study. If it will not, we issue something called a negative declaration stating that we consider these issues and that we can use mitigation measures for any potential impacts. And so for this, we would need a discussion if there is questions or anything, and then a motion and a resolution. Questions? I know I went through it real fast, but I know you have a lot on your agenda.
So the resolution would be to issue a negative declaration.
That's what it sounds like. It sounds like there won't be a negative declaration. I mean, based on everything that you just explained to us, it sounds like there would be a negative declaration.
Yes.
Okay.
Are you in the, you're in the bond resolution?
Actually, can I have this? I was thinking of the negative deck first.
Yeah.
Then the, but that's not what you're saying. What you're saying is in fact that this is.
We need to, so the bond resolution, which also authorizes application for the grant, is separate to SEACR.
Yep.
So we're going to conclude our SEACR, we're going to issue a SEACR determination of significance and findings first. Then we're going to consider the bond resolution, which will then, if that is resolved and approved by the board, will then authorize application for the grants. Does that make sense?
I think it does. I think that's what I'm trying to digest.
The board has to close SEACR by issuing a negative declaration before it can adopt the bond resolution. Once those two things are done, then you would be authorized to sign the application for submission. So if it pleases the board, I have a rough SEACR negative declaration, which, and Mary Beth, you can jump in here. It's pretty straightforward. Okay, so whereas the Village of Monroe Board of Trustees declared itself lead agency for the purpose of applying for a WIAA grant on July 24th, 2018. And whereas the notice of intent to be lead agency was duly circulated to all involved agencies, and whereas the all involved agencies consented to the Village Board of Trustees as lead agency, and whereas the Board of Trustees reviewed the full environmental assessment form prepared by Delaware Engineering with its consulting engineer, Delaware Engineering, as regards this project and application for grant, and whereas duly reviewing the full EAF, the board determined that this project was an unlisted action under the SEACR regulations. Now, therefore, the Village Board of Trustees hereby finds and determines that this that applying for this grant for the project to improve the water infrastructure will not have a significant impact on the environment as set forth in part three of the environmental assessment form, and declares a negative declaration, thus closing SEACR. Do I need to have that put in the form of a motion?
I'll put that in the form of a motion.
Second. I'll second.
Any further question? Call the question?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, so carried.
So as I said, in order to apply for the grant resolution. And I'm just going to read the first little bit. Bond resolution of the Village of Monroe, New York, adopted September 4th, 2018, authorizing construction of improvements to the village water system, stating the estimated maximum cost thereof $4,945,000. Appropriating said amount for such purpose and authorizing the issuance of bonds in the principal amount of $4,945,000 to finance said appropriation. The project is described to include reconstruction and replacement of water transmission line, water main replacements, a water main extension, water service relocation, improvements to the Pine Tree and Briarcliff pump stations, water plant electrical upgrades, and other ancillary and related work in connection hereof. So the other important parts of this are on the top of the second, third page, I guess it is. All or part of the cost of the project may be financed through New York State Environmental Facilities, EFC, State Revolving Fund, SRF, and or Water Infrastructure Improvement Act, WIIA, grant, and any authorized officer of the village is hereby authorized to submit an application and perform any other necessary acts to arrange for such financing. Most of the rest of this, and we should jump in, are statutory requirements of the local finance law with respect to these types of resolutions. The bond resolution is subject to permissive referendum, and the village clerk is hereby authorized and directed within 10 days after the adoption of this resolution to publish or cause to be published in full in the Herald Times Record, newspaper having general circulation within said village, and hereby designated the official newspaper of the village for such publication and posted in 6 public places in each polling place in the village. And then there's a format for that publication, and then there are signature pages for the clerk as a result of this discussion and consideration of the resolution. Again, I'll emphasize, no one's talking about spending any money at all, really. The process with the grants we apply now, if the past is any indicator of the future, like one of those commercials, financial commercials, we could expect to see a notification from the governor's office anytime in the late fall up to Christmas time. There's another set of grants that were due back in July that are traditionally announced the second week of December. These are generally announced before those grants. They haven't given themselves a tremendous amount of time, but we would expect to hear about this fall. And then from there, you could make a decision as to how you wanted to proceed with this if you received the grant. One of the questions that the mayor asked is this one of those grants where you apply for, you know, in our case, we're looking for about $3 million, which is the maximum amount of grant we can get. We have an approximately $5 million project, and the maximum is 60% or $3 million. We would get the maximum being $3 million. It is not the kind of grant where they give you less than you ask for. If they decide to invest in your project, they give you the maximum. If the project cost goes down for any reason, say you drop an element to the project, the grant will be reduced so that it is 60%. If you've got another grant, the total project cost minus that other grant, 60% of that number is what this grant would be. I just want everybody to be clear on that. This is one of those kinds of guys. So once you apply and you get that letter that says we're willing to give you $2,900,000, 60% of, you know, 4, 5, 9, 4, or whatever number is, that would be the maximum, and that we would have to spend the entire project budget to receive that funding. And again, not a bag of money. It acts as principal forgiveness, less money you borrow, and that's what the taxpayers pay back, what the ratepayers pay back. So that's traditionally how these work. From there, once you had a grant notice, you would have some decisions to make. You could wait for the state to wind its way through its delightful process that takes a long time to provide funding to go do all the things that you would need to do, design the project, get regulatory approvals, you know, get it out to bid, those kinds of things. Or if you decided that you wanted to make sure that you addressed the important infrastructure quicker, you could do a short-term borrowing, a bond anticipation note that would be authorized under this resolution. And then that would be refunded eventually when you do close on financing with the state. It would pay it all, plus net interest, the difference between what you pay and what you get from having the state's process, you're out there a bit. You're talking about receiving state funds in late 2019 and then doing design work in 2020 and getting out to bid thereafter. It sounds like it's forever from now. The state does not move quickly. If you chose to move more quickly, you could do that. You could, in the spring, if you received the grant, you could say, okay, well, on that basis, we're comfortable putting out a bond anticipation note, getting some money in hand, which would allow that process, the design process, to happen in 19. It could be out to bid in late 19 and in construction in 2020, so it actually takes a year off the process. Mm-hmm. You incur a little interest, but it takes a year off the process. We don't need to deal with those things right now, but I just wanted to explain, kind of soup to nuts, how the process works.
Right.
Other questions for me or Elise on the bond resolution?
No.
And then I can go over the grant applications real quick. People are still feeling patient.
So you would make a motion to adopt the bond resolution.
Resolution.
I'll make the motion.
And I'll second it.
Any further? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried.
So I will work with Margaret to get the postings and all the paperwork straightened out. So the last two items are really, you've done your actions, it's just I'm going to be giving the mayor some documentation to sign. These are the grant application, that's the first one that's kind of oriented this way. It's pretty straightforward. There's not a lot to it. Some very simple, straightforward answers to some questions. One thing to note is that when you do use the state's money, you are subject to their rules. That includes citing things like minority and women-owned business requirements in terms of participation, something called Davis-Bacon, which is a federal law regarding what people are paid. Workers are paid, construction workers are paid. New York State's prevailing wages are almost always higher than Davis-Bacon regulations, so it's not something we generally have to worry about other than acknowledging it. And we are also required to use American iron and steel for these projects. Again, not something you have to get too excited about, but if we go down the road, that would be a requirement. And then the last document, which is oriented, the first page is oriented this way, is an application for financing under something called the State Revolving Fund. You guys already have a borrowing under this program. It provides low-cost borrowing to communities, and this would be considered a co-funded project because you'd be looking at using two different forms of funding to support the project, and this is the borrowing chunk. So back to our example, if we have a $5 million project and we get 60% of $3 million in grant, we would eventually need to borrow $2 million. This is one of the avenues. You don't have to use this avenue, but it is an avenue that's available to you to get in on the state's, you know, AAA bond rating, get very low cost borrowing. You probably will be in a position to get market rate borrowing through this program. You all can go out and get your own market rate borrowing as well. You've done that in the past. The one thing that's nice about using the state's money through this program is these notes are long. They're either 20 or 30 years. And those are the two options. The state guarantees you that your interest rate is fixed. It will never go up, but it may go down. And in my experience, it frequently does. And they simply call you and say, send your paper and your interest rate goes down, which is a pretty nice deal. And the way they're doing that is this is a huge multi-billion dollar program with every municipality and state in it. And they sell these bonds on the market. They aggregate them and resell them, get a lower rate, aggregate, resell, get a lower rate, and they pass the lower rate on to you. So it's a nice deal. You don't have to use it, but this is sort of like opening the door to the opportunity. You can decide not to, but it strengthens the application as a co-funded application, and again, you don't really have to decide any of that stuff today. That will be in the future if you receive the grant and you want to. So you already took the action to authorize the mayor to execute these documents, which everyone will bear with me for just a second. I'm going to ask Neil to put his signature. My secretary was nice enough to put those little red sticky things on there. And then I have everything I need. I will coordinate with you, make sure you have a complete copy. The copy will be a PDF. So it'll be something you can put on the website if you want to. something that you can, you know, it's, we find they're much easier to use when they're digital than giving you a giant stack of paper. And we are good to go.
I see one thing.
Yeah.
The phone number for Village Hall is off by one digit.
Oh, okay. Please let me know what that should be, and I will.
So it says 845-782-9341.
What page is that?
The very first page.
And is it supposed to be?
8341.
8341. It's right on this page.
It's correct on that one?
It probably was a typo, if I had to guess. We are, I was telling you earlier, we are processing 13 of these applications.
Wow.
This is a highly competitive program. This program was originally authorized in 2015, there were only $400 million in it. It was reauthorized in 2017, and this year's allocation is well over $200 million. $40 million. This one's huge. This one, just for these programs, is significant. So the state put $1.6 billion in a 5-year program.
Just leave it.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone for your.
Thanks for all your work, Mary Beth.
Thank you, Mary Beth. I'm so out of order right now. Okay.
Mary Beth, we actually need a resolution authorizing the mayor to sign this.
It's in the non-position. The opposition was embedded in the non-position.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Safe trip home, Mary Beth.
Thank you, Mary Beth.
Bye, Ernie.
Okay, next order of business is the authorization of payment agreement for water account 231. Let's just identify 231 first.
231 is 9 Lakes.
No, no. 475 Route 17M.
Right, sorry.
So the history of it is that the water department generated a proposed agreement to offer the owner of the property or the business an opportunity to pay over time. Mm-hmm. We extended the opportunity as a board, and the action tonight has to authorize that to happen. So I need someone to make a motion that will allow this water account 231 to pay over an estimated 12-month period.
I'll make the motion.
Yes.
I'll second that motion.
Any further discussion? Just to make it clear, everybody, the issue at hand had to do with the water meter not working, not a problem of the client or the receiver of the water, but by the village. So based upon that, we had agreed that we would not put a penalty because it was our problem with the water meter. Okay, let's call the question.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, so carried. Thank you. Next piece is water account 2253. Similar situation, water meter was not working, and there was a inordinate amount of water that was being generated and pushed through the meter, and it was determined that the meter was at fault. And
no, 2253 is the meter. The new meter was installed, but the information was not input into the system.
Oh, it was a different meter type. Okay.
It was never put into the system, so
it was billing zero.
Because it wasn't not reading a meter, because it wasn't altering the meter.
All right, wait, this, so, okay. So at the end of the day, the meter that was inputted into the software that it was accepting was a different factor, and it created a overage in the water?
No.
No.
So they received a new meter, but she never was put into our water system.
Okay.
So it never generated a bill.
Okay.
So she never received a bill, which is why.
Okay. All right, so the usage, the amount of gallons is correct?
Yes.
And the appropriate dollars is correct?
Yes.
Correct.
Right. And then we've sent them also. Okay, so we need to make a motion to offer this client, rate user, the ability to pay over time without penalty.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Okay. I do have one question. The agreement that we agreed to does limit the amount of time before the payment's in full, if I remember correctly.
Yes, it does.
And should it not? They're both village accounts. One's a commercial, and the other one's a village account.
It was my understanding that they were the accounts were to be handled exactly the same. So, Amara, do you have any?
I can't speak on this because this happened without my knowledge.
Well, it's not, you know.
So it's two different.
Nothing's happened. We're making a resolution tonight to accept the terms of 12 months. Mm-hmm.
12 months apply to. So the question is, do we apply that as a standard practice over all accounts that where the village was at large?
Right. That's
that
right. Yes.
Whether they're commercial or residential.
Doesn't matter.
Or do you determine maybe, or do you determine more time if it's more money or if it's a different account? I mean, is that the question?
Well, the question is if the time period under which they sign off on the agreement closes out, sunsets,
mm-hmm.
and there is no, and there's a balance of $1,000.
Right.
Is the interest now accruing on the $1,000 plus the current bill at hand, right? Forget the current bill. That's part
well,
of my protocol.
Well, if you're saying you owe us X and you have 12 months to pay it off and they don't pay it off by the end of 12 months, then the village, I think, would be within its...
Obligated to trigger a penalty, right?
Yeah, I think you could then begin charging the penalty. You need to let them know that.
Okay.
I think it would be on
the outstanding
balance.
Right. I would agree. Okay.
So you can adopt that as a standard practice going forward.
Well, that's what I want to do. That's actually probably the third piece of this that probably is not inclusive to this, but to create a policy so that we can deal with things like this.
So why don't we just do it?
Earlier this year, I believe, we offered him a payment arrangement. It was not the village's fault. We gave him 3 months to pay. For
right,
his
but that was his.
A less amount, but I'm just wondering. Are
I think the premise here, though, is if it's a village, if it's the fault of the village, we're going to apply this theory.
Right.
Not if it's because the customer failed to pay his bill. I think we're just going to beat a horse if we're going to apply it, we apply it. If we're doing it because it's our error, then I think we need to stick to that. The bill's $600. I don't think anybody would take 12 months to pay $600 off.
But they could.
They could.
Of course they could.
Otherwise,
they could.
Every single time this happens, you're going to
we're going to be doing this again and again.
What you're doing is you're giving the water department direction.
Mm-hmm.
If this happens, it's the village's fault for whatever reason,
mm-hmm.
inadvertent, then offer them this plan.
Right. So 12 months.
And unless there's something that's really outside the norm, then,
right.
then the water department can come to the village board. I mean, I think that's what
right.
you're talking about, correct?
It is.
Mm-hmm.
I just made the assumption that maybe we make a motion to offer this account. This opportunity,
mm-hmm.
and then I think it's a separate motion to adopt a policy, or to write a policy and adopt it, that says here's the triggers on certain things, certain events.
Yeah, I think you can do that.
Rather than including it into this
night. No, that's you're correct.
Right.
You should in fact separate
Right.
Okay, all right, so this applicant would follow the same lead. It would be a 12-month period, no penalties during that period, and payment would be due in full at the end of that 12-month period.
And penalties assessed
on any unpaid balance. I need someone to make a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I will second.
Yeah, we are already.
Oh.
Any further? Call the question?
Aye.
Aye. Should we go back and?
Yep.
Well, before we do that, should we, I don't think we included the dollar amount on the first one, where if they didn't make payment, wasn't concluded by the end of 12 months, they would receive a.
Yeah, you would just hear note on the record that you're conforming.
Okay.
To the policy.
Okay.
To the here and after adopted policy.
Okay.
Which you're gonna do now, unless you wanna get to this third one. Yeah, which I think is a completely different situation, so.
All right, so let's just get the policy worked out. So basically, it boils down to the village is in error. There should be an opportunity for the ratepayer to have an opportunity to pay it over time without penalty. So that's established, right?
Yes.
Well, it's, I think it's 12 months.
Yeah, I think you could say that the village board of trustees hereby establishes a policy to be a policy as follows, where a water account is delinquent because of an error by the village. The water department is hereby authorized and directed to offer that delinquent account holder a period of 12 months to pay off the delinquent bill in equal measure over 12 months or sooner. And that any outstanding balance on that, and that no fees would be charged, and that any outstanding balance at the end of that 12 months
would be subject to
penalties.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the.
I'm sorry, Neil, but does that mean if another situation should arise like this, the water department will not have to prepare a memo and bring it to the board's attention, that they can just go ahead and do that? Okay.
Right. Yep.
The only time they would do that is if there's some question.
Some really mitigating circumstances, but I think to bring some more fluidity to their department without encumbering them with board meetings and resolutions and stamps of approval, and I think it would really be great that if we just do this, this would really help them a lot, I think.
I make the motion, we accept the.
So the Board of Trustees hereby establishes the policy as follows. Any water account which is in arrears due to the Village of Monroe's error, the Water Department and its clerks is hereby authorized to offer an agreement to that ratepayer to pay out the outstanding balance over a 12-month period. Should any outstanding balance be due and payable after the 12-month period, it will begin to incur interest at the standard rate the Village Water Department has applied.
Right.
Okay, I need a motion.
So I make the motion, we accept the resolution.
I'll second.
Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried, thank you.
Yes.
Okay, water account 10257.
It's the same.
I'm not quite sure what the board is being asked here. Maybe
this is the one that you did, right?
No.
This isn't the same one.
Oh, this is 422, right?
422 spring. They have not submitted.
This is a town account outside of our ability for the most part. The landowner purchases the property. He purchases with an outstanding water bill, I think, of about $83,000 on the account.
But it says here that at the closing, the bank advised that a payment of $36,900 would be forwarded to the village and was paid. So are
right.
you saying that they owed more than that?
Yes. So in other words, take the 36 off of the 80-something, and now you've got a $50-something-thousand-dollar balance, which has still been accruing interest since the time that payment was made.
But why did they only get a bill for $36,900?
They didn't get a bill. They got a bill for $83,000. When they did a closing reading here,
okay.
they were told, this is what you owe, and you need to pay this bill.
And they've been now getting continuous bills, and they're not paying? Or they're paying?
As far as I know, he hasn't paid anything. Other than the 30,
that's the only
payment.
That's
the
only
payment.
Right.
The person who bought the property requested a final water read in April of 2017, filled out the final water read, the document is included. He was notified of the outstanding balance of $83,000 and whatever. That happened to coincide with the day that Trustee Conkle was here. He did not know that he was speaking with a trustee outside, but she spoke to him about it, made a comment about the large bill. He acknowledged the large bill then. The closing didn't happen in April. It was pushed back to August. The closing happened unbeknownst to the village, and at which point, when it happened, we received a letter from them claiming that they didn't know about the balance, but that they were willing to pay $36,000, but they didn't think that they should have to pay the balance since they weren't aware of it when they purchased the property. It went before the board in November, and the board denied the request to waive the balance. And that's where it was. When the water billing clerks were reviewing all of the water accounts recently, this came up and they presented it to the board the beginning of August just as a, what do you want to do with this? But there has been no contact from the current owner requesting anything of the village board.
And he's getting water?
No.
So the water's been turned off?
Yes, the property's abandoned.
So you've already exercised your option to turn off the water.
Yes.
And is the property now up for sale again? Is that
well? I don't. The water was shut off before he purchased this home. There was an it was abandoned. There was an issue with the water running. I don't know if they cut pipes out of it. I don't really know how the water bill got that big, but the water was shut off. So he purchased the house, the water was never turned back on. I would imagine he needs to do extensive work in there to be able to run water.
So the water was shut off, but he had an $83,000 bill.
I talked to him outside. I couldn't believe that his water bill was that high.
It wasn't him that incurred the $83,000.
Right, but at a closing, water bills must be paid. So obviously something went wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So at this point, the board's options are to take this guy to court to try and get your money. One. Two, just wait until someone tries to turn the water on, and now they have a bill. So, I mean, those are your two options as I see them right now. Has he had any communication from the board or from the water department? Does he continue to get bills?
Yes.
And he's just ignoring. If he's just letting the property sit there, he doesn't need the water right now.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. So, you know, I think that we can talk about this. Maybe I can discuss this with the mayor and one trustee off, you know, offline. Do you want to incur the expense of a Supreme Court action to get this money? And then the other thing we discussed was the water, you know, the new water agreements. Okay, so that. But under the law, you can always take someone to court. I think the amount is too much to begin taking people to justice court. That's the issue. So.
Right.
Because if you begin taking them to justice court for smaller amounts, those can be leaned as judgments. But that's not the case here.
Too big an amount.
It's too big an amount.
offline and just kind of table it?
Yeah, you'll have to table it to discuss, you know, whether you want to litigate or not.
Yep.
Or adopt a law that would allow the village to be able to put unpaid water rents onto a town tax bill?
No, you cannot do that under state law. That's been the problem. Can't do it.
Okay.
Okay. Next piece is the revised children's ticket for Founders Day dinner and movie.
Yes, going over the details for dinner and a movie, I would like to revise the ticket price for children from $20 per person to $15 per person. And I'd also like to shorten the time to 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. I think keeping it to 10 p.m. on a Sunday night is might keep some people away. So.
Okay, so 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. and $15 per child.
So I put that in the form of a motion.
No, second it.
Further discussion? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried. Thank you. Okay. Next one is the an event application. Ready, Set, Glow, 5K. The Harper Smiles Foundation submitted an event application to host an event, a 5K race utilizing the walking paths around Crane Park on Saturday, October 27, 2018, from 4:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. The nighttime neon 5K run will also include a kids' dash, costume contest, and a trick or treat.
Trunk or treat.
Yep.
Trunk?
Decorate your trunk.
Candy in there and the kids go. It's pretty cool.
I just says truck, I'm asking. In addition to the utilization of the walking paths, they're also requesting that Lake Street be closed during the event between Mill Pond Parkway and 17M, where registration tables will be set up, tables to host the trunk or treat, as well as to serve cider, donuts, and other fall snacks. Harper Smiles has provided documentation confirming their 501c3 status. Both the building department and police departments have signed off on the events. Estimated cost of additional police servicing this project or this event is $355 and will include one officer on 5 hours overtime to assist the Sea Lion offices with shutting down Lake Street from Mill Pond to Route 17M and to provide traffic control for the race. Due to the cost of the one-day special policy, the Harper Smiles Foundation will provide a certificate of insurance liability naming the village as additional insured once the event has been approved. So I need a motion.
I'll second.
Call the question?
Aye.
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 So carried. Thank you. Absolutely. Thank you so much for having it.
Sounds like fun. It does sound like fun.
And it's a track or treat, right?
It is a track.
Yeah, I just saw that. It's
totally made up.
And no, it's awesome. So you're going to do it right on the track? It's awesome.
Oh, okay.
If you need volunteers, let me know.
Yes.
Yes.
Who would we get in touch with? If we want to try to get the businesses involved, is there, can we get a contact from you?
Yep. Absolutely. I'm going to tell you right now. And just a heads up, if you wouldn't mind, just tell us Harper Smiles Foundation. Yeah, I just want folks to know about it.
Yeah.
You're on
anything
air.
You guys need, you let us know.
Thank
I'm
you.
On board.
Need.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay. Quarterstone Masonic Lodge, their 5K race. An events application was submitted by the Masonic Historical Society for their 5K race on September 29 from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. It's comprised of two loops around the Mill Pond, starting and ending at 26 Mill Pond Parkway, as per the route race submitted with the events application. Sign-off has been done by both departments. Police will oversee the event, one officer on 3 hours of overtime. to shut down Mill Pond Parkway at Smithfield Court and Stage Road, as well as traffic control. The estimated cost of the police is $214.35. I need a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Call the question.
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried, thank you. Second event application by the Cornerstone Masonic Lodge is for on the same day from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. They want to have their annual Oktoberfest festival. Two tents will be erected, one for seating, the other one for food services, and must be a 20-foot separation between the tents. Fire extinguishers will be located at each side of the tent, and a certificate from the Department of Health is also required and will be provided to the village clerk prior to the event. There will be a stage and band performing. A copy of the outdoor state liquor license must be filed with the village clerk as well prior to the event, and police department prior to the event. Music must comply with the village's noise ordinance, code 145-3. Sign up for the event application has been made by both the building and the police departments. I need a motion to
I'll make a motion
that.
Pending we get the liquor license certification and the Board of Health certification.
Agreed.
I'll second.
Call a question?
Aye.
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 And that's pending. Okay. Is I don't see him here. Is Nick Gordon here? No, right?
No.
Okay. All right. Let me just pull something out, and maybe we'll talk about it a couple of minutes here. Okay, so we received a letter from MJS Engineering, the consultant for the Monbassia Fire Company. We had taken an action last month to waive all the fees associated with the project, in particular, I guess, the building permit fees and so forth. I don't remember specifically, but and the bond fee, I think it was, the bond fee is what they'd like to see. I'm sorry? Site plans, right. So the fire company would like to request a waiver of the bond amount, which was not waived during the previous Village of Monroe bond meeting. I have attached a letter that was sent to the Village Bond Committee discussing this matter. And I don't know if you're able to or if we want to address it in this manner. John, you wouldn't be able to speak on behalf of the fire company, would you? Okay, thank you. All right, so.
I don't have much time to
be on there. Don't tell me. Okay. All right, so in any event, I know we took up what was asked of us at the last meeting and
yes.
addressed it accordingly. I think we went so far as to consider the ancillary or the.
Incidentals.
And then decided not to get involved in that. But anyway, this is now asking, and I don't even know what the fee schedule would be. I know it's a percentage. I know in my world it's a percentage of the performance. In this day, in this particular job, it's a $43,000 estimated cost. So should, for whatever reason, their contractor not be able to live up to his contract, a bond company calls in the bond and then pays up the balance to get the work completed so that the fire company is made whole. And I don't know what that amount is. I don't see the follow-up letter in the file. Sure, sorry.
I just text Nick.
Yeah, he was actually on the agenda as the person to be here. All right, that's fine, thanks. Yeah, no, that's fine. I mean, it's something I could probably straighten out by tomorrow, but
I mean, it looks like they're asking you to accept the bond amount.
No, there's gonna be a cost to that bond.
Yes, I see that.
And I guess if we were to waive it, they wouldn't have to go out and procure one. That's the way I'm reading it. Yeah,
so
you know.
Should we table this?
Let me just read this one more time.
But the issue for me was there is no supporting letter. Because we did take on the action that they requested of us last meeting. Well, 2 meetings ago, and then subsequent to that, we came back with the incidental issue.
Yes.
Do you want to see the original letter that we received first time and only time from Mavisha, where they requested the, I think it came to a little over $2,000?
No, this is, this, they don't want to take the bond out. That's how I read this.
That's how I read it, exactly.
You always have the bond if something happens, and they don't want to have to do that under your site plan. You know, your engineer said it's going to cost $43,000.
Right.
You need a bond in case your contractor goes out of business or something.
Mm-hmm.
And let's say the fire district has paid the contractor half
the fire district. Fire company.
Okay, the fire company has paid the contractor half of the cost, and then he goes out of business. Now the fire company now has to go hire somebody else to finish it, and they have to pay him some portion of the whole amount again. So the bond says, okay, right? Neil,
yes.
You understand this. So
yeah.
What the bond does, it protects the fire company in case something happens. The surety comes in and they're required to finish the job based on this amendment.
Right.
So
that's a huge risk for them.
Well, Mr. Nick Gordon was supposed to.
Right.
Maybe.
And Margaret, if you have that copy of that that original letter, then this way when I go to speak to him about it, I get it straightened out. Thank you.
All right. I just got a message from Nick. It said, Village never got back to me to let me know if we were on the agenda.
Okay. What I have here, this is August 21. This is from Michael Sandor. He just states, Mr. Nick Gordon, Building Committee Chairman of the Monbeisha Firehouse, will represent the fire company to request this waiver.
Oh,
yeah, it does. I think you're right here. Yeah, I think it was communication, John, you're right. Just let him know, and then I'll let him know I'm going to reach out to him.
All right,
thank you.
A lot of times bonds cost, you know, I don't know what they cost, but they might be 1 to 2 to 5% of, you know, the cost of the amount.
Right.
So.
Okay, so we'll just table it. I'll have a conversation with the building committee and Mr. Gordon, and we'll bring it to the next. The project, as it stands right now, John, is queued for what, you know, timeline?
I'm not sure on the timeline. They haven't brought it back yet before the membership.
Oh, okay.
I'm trying to get all the nuts and bolts together before.
All right, well, we're meeting on the 18th?
I don't think it's going to happen, you know, before.
Okay.
The
all right. All right. Otherwise, I would, you know, I mean, I'm going to speak to him tomorrow for sure, but all right, so we'll table that. And I'll get that other letter, and then we'll go at it. Thank you. Okay, authorization for Verizon Wireless alterations on Bald Hill cell tower. The building department has received a permit application by T-Mobile for alterations to the existing cell tower located on Bald Hill. As part of the building department requirements, the property owner must consent to the work before he can begin, and consent is given by the property owner signing off on the permit application. Since Bald Hill is owned by the Village of Monroe, the Village Board must consent to the work and authorize the mayor to sign the permit application. The description of the project consists of adding a 1 delta 25 kW the DC diesel generator on existing 12 by 20 pad. Discussion, no, that's it. So, I need someone to make a motion that we allow this company to come in and make these modifications on our property.
I'll make the motion. I'll second it.
Okay, call the question.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, so carried. Okay. A traffic safety. Please, Trustee Houle.
Yes, in a memo from Sergeant Amatetti, of the Monroe Police Department. They have been awarded $1,000 by the New York State Governor's Traffic Safety Committee to participate in the statewide child passenger safety program. The grant period runs from October 1st of 2018 through September 30th of 2019.
Board would accept the grant?
So I ask the board to accept the grant.
Can I get a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Very good. Call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye. So carried. Thank you very much. Okay. Let's. Okay, another water account. This is account 10171. The property owner has asked for some relief. Just give me a moment. I'll read through the notes here. He wrote a letter to me, and he said, I'm writing this letter regarding the water bill attached that I received for the first time in my mail for address 2 Orico Terrace. Which I own since September of 16 in the amount of, and he mentions the amount that he owes, $2,866.97. He's paid the bill, but he's now asking for the penalty portion of that bill, which totals $2,023.76, to be considered by this board to be a refund to him, as he believes or tells us that he has never received the bill prior to this one. So, do you have anybody else have the water count? You have the water count? No. Okay.
I do, yes.
Yeah.
I gave it to you.
Yeah, okay. All right, what it boils down to is this then. So, he purchased the property, and, you know, he's responsible to pay his bill.
Yep.
So, we cannot abate a refund or do anything by law to this if he's responsible to pay his bill, and that's in fact the case. So what's before you now is to make a decision and vote as to whether or not to refund the money or to deny the refund. Everybody got that?
Yeah.
Okay. So somebody has to put a motion on the table to deny the refund of the penalty.
I will make a motion that we deny the refund of the penalty on water account 10171.
Okay, second?
I'll second it.
Call the question?
Aye.
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 So carried.
Would the board consider a policy of just simply noting us? It seems like
we get like four every meeting.
Yeah, four every meeting. Said, if it's our fault, here's what we're going to do. But if it's not our fault, especially where I didn't get the bill or I bought this property at foreclosure and whatever, you know, I suppose people could always ask for redress, but maybe that you have a policy that, you know, you can't be giving people refunds.
Right.
And knocking off, you know, out of taxpayer money. So the people pay their water bills. So the people who pay should not be funding the people who do not pay.
Right.
So, I mean, you don't have to do anything right now. You might want to consider
right.
And then that can be given to people, just a response
when they
come
to Village Hall.
And if there's an extraordinary circumstance, then maybe that's a reason to take it under consideration. But you deny them. I mean, I don't think you've gone into the one.
No. I think the major issue sometimes is when people acquire property, they have the obligation to do their due diligence, and that includes, you know, what an attorney, what you would pay an attorney to do, which would include any municipal searches, any of this, any of that. There's all kinds of pieces of this. At that time, if he had done that, he would have learned about this. At
is
that
it
time.
Village property?
Yeah.
Is it village property? No,
this
is a town water account.
This is a
Oh, I'm sorry, is it a town?
Yes.
Okay. I thought it was still village.
The premise is still the same.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they're just not following the procedure. And the issue was, the house was sold, we weren't notified who purchased it, so to alleviate the bill being sent and forwarded to the prior owner, wherever that person may be, forwarded by the post office, the water department would then just adjust the bill to read current resident at the property address.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so we need to schedule a public hearing to introduce local law.
Via email?
Yeah. You only sent it to the online, the local person, local law, and distributed it in your email in everybody's box.
Okay.
They got the local law. They have it.
Oh, they do have it. Oh.
It doesn't matter. What, you know, what should happen at this point is the resolution says that, you know, on this, whereas on this date, this local law to establish maximum gross residential floor area ratios for dwellings within certain districts is hereby placed on the desk of the village board for its consideration. And the village board makes a motion to set a public hearing. There was more to the resolution than is quite what's here.
And I'm sorry. Honestly, in all fairness, I thought that was just a recommendation because historically, this is just how they set the date. But I can certainly insert the verbiage.
Yes.
Yeah, that's fine. I think it's just
introduced a local law before we just set the public hearing date.
The way, you know, under the state statute for adopting local laws, the first thing you have to do is you have to set. You have to introduce it formally by resolution to the board. So now it's on your desk. And that has to be done 7 days before the date of the public hearing. So the resolution is structured so that it's introduced and then you're setting a public hearing for no sooner than like 7 days after. Okay.
So the first piece of this is to introduce the local law to the board, right? So I need to make a resolution, or I need someone to make a resolution?
I'll make a motion that we introduce
Local Law
number 7 of 2018, amending Chapter 200 of the Village Code zoning.
Which establishes a maximum gross residential floor area ratio.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'll second it.
Can I call the question?
Aye.
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 Aye, so carried. Now we need to schedule a public hearing date. And it needs to be 7 days. Our meeting is the 18th, so we will do the public hearing on the same day.
At 6:30.
Okay. I need a motion.
I'll make the motion.
Second?
I will second.
Anything further on that? No. Call the question?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, so carried. Thank you. Okay. Okay, next two pieces almost run concurrent, but establish something that we need to get a hold of here. Mm-hmm. The first one is a discussion of property maintenance law. I need someone to make a motion authorizing council to work on establishing a property maintenance law for the Village of Monroe, and to work with the building department and the board in establishing that, so that we can bring that to the village's use. I'm going to make a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
Okay. Call the question?
Aye.
Aye, so carry.
Not that we don't give you enough to do, at least.
Well, I know the building inspector has the state code that he enforces, and you also have something called vegetation.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't see in your code any actual property maintenance local law, so that a village or town can establish standards that are local. That may not be in the state code, but that which you believe is important for the, you know, the look and the feel of your village. So how high is the grass, et cetera. So I will draft some a property maintenance law, and in the meantime, you guys be thinking about those areas that really bother you that
so
you want
to
address.
So at this juncture, we could change it from 12 inches to 6 inches.
That's right.
Absolutely.
Excellent.
And then what do we do if the lawn is past that height?
Well, that's
same thing we always
yeah,
do.
Yeah, there's a process in the state law required. But that would also include the public, should they have any opportunity or interest in anything that they deem is important for the board to be aware of, that we can work with the attorney in promoting this. We should encourage that as well. Okay? All right.
And we'll just email you our suggestion?
Yes.
Yeah, and the public should email the village or myself as well.
Okay.
They still have the opportunity to make suggestions during the public hearing?
Oh,
sure. Absolutely. That's the purpose. Absolutely. But preemptively, if we could roll something out with these comments included, I would encourage everyone to do that. And in the same light, specifically, we have a situation where we have on a property here in the Village of Monroe an abandoned vehicle. And I did some research with the Village Police Department, and I come to find out, no surprise probably to anybody, that the vehicle is owned by the prior owner.
Mm-hmm.
And that the property that is currently owned by I suppose an LLC, most likely, okay, is not addressing it. So I'd like to talk about that particular specific instance with the board and have a discussion, because it's got to be dealt with. I mean, the tires are flat now on this particular vehicle. The windows are open. It's clearly abandoned. And if you did a DMV, which I had the PD do, it belongs to the prior owner. So I need to find out what we can legally do to get rid of that car.
Well, under 185.18, police power to remove vehicles, your code states that the police department shall have the power to require tow vehicles to remove vehicles where, and there's a list, it's obstructing a public right-of-way, it's been vandalized, the vehicle has been vandalized or presents a fire or safety hazard, or is an attractive nuisance, or it's an abandoned vehicle that bears no discernible registration or identification data, or an abandoned vehicle is not licensed or operable, or a vehicle is violating any emergency no parking provisions, or it's catch-all, any other condition where permitted or required by law. So I think if this vehicle is abandoned,
and
I
think
the village can have it towed.
Okay.
The police department can have it towed. So
even though it's on private property.
Yes. I mean, it's abandoned.
But do we know that? I want to play this whole thing out. Do we know that it's abandoned, or can we assume that the previous owner said, "Here you go. Here's the title. I don't want it," and then the new owners just haven't done anything with it yet.
The old owners are both dead.
Well, is the property that it's on, what's happening with the property that's owned?
when I went through, they were renovating it. I don't know what they're doing with it now.
Are they,
John, are they, when I came through, they were working in there. I don't know if they still are.
They are working in there. They've gotten the house and we've done it. There's been several old dumpsters in it and the car still sits there.
You know, the car, without a doubt, the car is an eyesore.
But it has an owner. It has, we know who the owner is, but the owners are dead.
The owners are both deceased. The lady died in the house and he died coming out of the house.
Oops.
You
know, it may be just as a first step. Do you know if the building inspector has sent a letter?
No. So what's happened is we initially, the first go around on this, we investigated it. Obviously, it's got no tags on it, and that was the first way we went at it. Then I come to find out, in our code, we allow one untagged vehicle per residential property.
Okay.
So, and to the point of that, and I've spoken to several people about it.
Yeah.
So, if you have, say, somebody who either seasonally uses a vehicle and not other times, a student in college, you don't want to be paying for the licensing and tags and insurance, you take it off the road. But this is, in my opinion, and what is my opinion, probably mean nothing, but it doesn't meet that.
It's not operable. It's not
right.
An operable.
No, the tires are flat.
Four flat tires. Right.
Well, but that's, I mean, to play devil's advocate, because I have a neighbor who has a project car. There's no tags on it. It's not registered. I believe it's up on blocks. He does work on it every
2 months.
I don't even think it's that often. So where do we draw that line where this is their property and this is obviously something that is turning into a giant junk heap?
Well, the major difference for me, and you're right, because that's what happens when you start cooking this pot over here for this,
mm-hmm.
You've now done it to the village.
Mm-hmm.
So when you equal handed everything, this case, it's a prior owner. It's not the current owner.
Mm-hmm.
Not like your case, this is the current owner.
Mm-hmm.
This is a prior owner. So there's no ownership to this vehicle. Unless, to Irene's point, the new owner, even though, I don't know, did the people die when they transferred deed or were they dead already? 18 piece all. So who settled the estate? Do you know anything about that part of it?
House went up for auction, $259,000.
Contents and all.
Well, that's so now the new owner of the property.
That's what I'm asking. Does
car.
He own the vehicle? That's my point.
I would assume he
so
does.
Then I think the letter to the new owner and or the LLC to give him notice that this vehicle has been considered abandoned and da 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 da.
And
it
get
it off your property.
Yeah, that's the same problem on Franklin Avenue.
It's everywhere.
Does
it is.
Listen,
yes.
Is
that's
can I interject quickly?
No.
We also have code on the litter, 135.
Right.
And under litter, it defines litter, which includes refuse. Definition of refuse includes abandoned vehicles. Under chapter 135.18 says the owner of private property is the main premises of litter for it. So then under 135.20, the clerk can issue notice to remove the litter if a nuisance or danger to public health, safety, and welfare. And then we also have under 135.21, the Department of Public Works superintendent can issue an appearance ticket for violation.
Right.
So it sounds like that vehicle could fall under litter.
Well, yeah, I mean.
Yeah,
exactly, and that's the part you don't want to split hairs with somebody. If this guy doesn't want the vehicle, then he's going to get rid of it. You know what I mean? Not let it sit there.
And if he wants it, he can pull it in his garage and shut the
door. But it's got to come off the driveway.
Well, the garage is being made into rooms.
But anyway,
did they
I think
get permits
that's
for that?
My goal, just to be clear, is to make sure that we're looking at the quality of life, and particularly since I've been down at your development forever with regard to some of the issues down here, we've got to find ways and tools that this board sanctions and resolves to pass that addresses those kinds of issues. You know, they're not unique. We just mentioned there's a property on Franklin that has the same issue. Yeah. So we've got to start getting the teeth to bite into these problems, and it's as simple as that. And I think the property maintenance law is going to go a far way, and I've got a lot of pieces that that say, here's what we need. And I think that's important. So I think a letter from the Village of Monroe sent to this owner of this LLC asks him to, and certified, asks him to address this problem. And how many days do we give him to do that? 7 days?
Yeah, 7 days, 10 days.
Okay. We do that, and...
Did that come from me or from the building department under that code? Because I know that there's a lot of ambiguity between building does one thing, but I do grass and unshoveled sidewalks.
It would be better, I think, to come from the building department, just ask Jim about it, and just say what you, you know, say, this is what we need to do. There do you have any code that you can cite to buy?
Right, and then to that point, because you noticed a couple, Anthony noticed a couple that could possibly fit into this narrow issue.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm saying is, because once you fit something into that narrow issue, you start bringing Trustee Hull's neighbor. And you have to be ready to get into that, because there may be 15 project cars in the village. You know, Uncle Alex maybe wants to have his pickup truck untagged and sitting in the driveway. Neighbor doesn't like it. What do we do with that vehicle? Well, we just passed a law, or we just came in on some narrow statute that says we could pull that thing out of your driveway. It's the United States of America.
Well, if it's abandoned.
If it's abandoned, but then you got to determine.
I think we need to define abandoned.
That's right. So what's the criteria? That's what I'm saying. That's what this is about. I want to define it so that when we pull the trigger on something, it's done. This back and forth over the last 10 months on this car is just absolutely over the top.
Okay. That's the purpose of a local property maintenance law.
Exactly.
Address issues like that.
Exactly. So let's go at that and figure out how we're going to do that. But I think a letter to him citing these issues and say, listen, can you deal with this on the village's behalf based on these cited codes sections? Yes or no? If he says no, we're coming back here next meeting and we're going to develop it and we're going to pass our own local law as part of that comprehensive property maintenance law. And that's going to be the end of it.
For now, to address this car.
All right. Well, yeah, Margaret, you're going to go ahead and reach out to him on that. And
then we'll,
yeah.
He needs to prepare this.
Yep, and he needs to find out whether these cited codes, statutes, apply, and or does the New York State Property Maintenance Code have any provisions in it to deal with this particular vehicle. Just a question. Do you think there'd be something to, what do you think the timeline would be to establishing that property maintenance law? Just to get a draft, just a thought.
I can have something in draft form by the next meeting.
Yeah?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
It's going to be draft.
Yeah. Well, like you just said, sometimes these things are specific to the Village of Monroe. So between public input, trustees' input, and everybody, it's going to be more of a custom made.
Yeah.
Okay. So 19.
Many municipalities deal with all of these issues all of the time.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a lot of templates that I can look at, and I've drafted some for other municipalities. So I'll start with those.
Well, I have it on this, some piece that I did forget to add, but I think I'd like to discuss now, is the discussion about the cease and desist.
Cease and desist.
Regarding solicitation and peddlers and so forth.
Yes, and I have not.
That's fine. I just want that on the record. So just to follow up you could put this into your minutes, Anne Margaret, is that there's a municipality in New York that has a ordinance that was passed in their community, which talks about their community wide, you cannot solicit.
Yeah.
Period. Just can't. And I want us to get that. So.
Okay. So there are peddling laws and solicitation laws where you can, with, you know, you have to get a license from the municipality. I don't know if you're.
We have that.
Mm-hmm. All right. So this is separate.
Yeah.
Or we may be able to work it into that. I'd have to look at it. Okay.
I just want it to be as comprehensive so that, you know, all the slipping and sliding and meeting and meeting and meeting over the same bloody thing is just,
okay,
it takes the air right out of my lungs.
When you say that, do you mean those that go door to door? Because we do have to issue peddling and soliciting permits for,
right,
the ice mother, the Mr. Dingling who goes around his ice.
No, I'm, yeah, I'm talking about like somebody had said to me, somebody shows up at their property and they, you know, they drive around in a circle. And then they come back and they want to talk to you from the curb. It's unsolicited.
Well, I told you I had two come down my driveway.
That's
two,
right,
weeks ago when I engaged him in a conversation,
right,
took his business card, and then informed,
right,
him, I'm the village clerk and I know that you're breaking the law because I didn't give you a permit. And he was,
that's
like,
right,
I don't need one. And I said, I beg to differ.
Right.
Which is so ironic because
if I wanted to sell my house.
We both, my father and I, have the no soliciting signs. Unfortunately, my father took mine down when he mowed my lawn. Anyway, his is still standing, so they didn't go to his house because his sign was up, but came to mine.
And ironically, they informed me that they could do what they were doing because they had the no solicitation list. And I said, liar, liar, pants on fire, because I didn't give that to you either. And no, you only get that when you get the permit, and I didn't give you one. So I can call the police and send you on your way.
And we will. That's the point. That's it. No more.
Okay.
Okay, that was just that last piece. I don't have anything in my report outside of that. I probably do, but I don't.
Oh, I wanted to say something about the flags, the Village Monroe,
oh,
flags.
Yeah.
They look great.
Awesome.
They do look fantastic, don't they?
Yeah. And the teal bulls look really good, too.
The teal bulls do look
Kathy
nice.
Yep.
Has anybody seen the banners downtown on the lights?
They look really nice.
Don't they look lovely?
And, that's
and
a,
with
that
those flowers, too, they look gorgeous. They really do.
You could use more. Yeah.
Well, it's part of a much
oh,
more.
Oh, we have more. We're just trying to figure out where the rest of them are going to go and
like
what poles. I do like every other, too. Mm-hmm.
And it's part of more a more comprehensive plan to include honoring those who have served or paid the ultimate price. Canyon of Heroes.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, awesome. Anybody else, Irene?
Nothing.
Next Tuesday is September 11th. The ceremonies that have gone on since 2001 will continue on Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. at the 9/11 Memorial. I've been in touch with the ambulance corps, and they're going to take care of the wreaths, and we're all set for that.
Awesome.
Mayor, I'd like to thank the Highway Department for taking care of preparing 9/11.
Yeah.
Farms. 30 flowers will be planted this coming Thursday.
Thursday,
so
yep.
If you ladies and gentlemen have energy to want to plant flowers, you're more than welcome at 4:30.
I'll be there. Awesome. Okay, without further ado, public comment, please. John.
Just a couple of things to follow up from the last meeting regarding portable basketball.
Yes.
Oops, we're going to want to call them,
yep,
the streets. Mm-hmm. I make out with that.
I assume that would fall under the property maintenance law, no?
I'm trying to tie in.
They're in the
street.
Right down there tonight, it's still there.
Right. Well,
I guess I verbally told you, hopefully it's in your village minutes, because if a car drives into one of these things in the middle of the night,
I know.
You can put on no
Probably the 6th.
Number one. Regarding the property maintenance, again, the snow, winter's coming, the sidewalks, the schools, the OAC kids trudging down the street.
So we have, there we have enforcement ability, and that will be enforced.
What happened last year?
Listen, I.
Honestly, I can speak on that since I'm the one that issues the violations. Violations are only issued if a written complaint is received. End of story. And I did issue some.
Does it have to be an adjoining property owner? Does it have to be?
I'm sorry, John, say that again.
Does it have to be an adjoining property owner?
No, if you have an issue in your neighborhood that's not on your street, on another street.
I'm referring to North Main Street right now.
And actually, I did specific to two areas on North Main issue violations.
Isn't there a time period for that as well?
There is the threshold.
It is off the top of my head, but it depends on the height of the snow.
Depends on the snow event.
And when it ends. And in both of those instances, given the nature and amount of the snow, the letters were sent, but I even called the property owners that day saying, I'm putting a violation in the mail. You need to send someone immediately to clear it because our children are walking in the street. But again, only if a written complaint is received.
And if you don't feel, and listen, just FYI on that, because I've dealt with this with other residents, if you don't feel like you want to make that complaint, then just get in touch, ask the mayor, call the village and say, I need to speak to the mayor. I am going to call you, and I will take that complaint, and I will file it on someone else's behalf.
Look, last week I took a picture, which I sent to you, and also to Tony here, of cars congregating, blowing horns at 7:30 in the morning, two houses down from me, in this boarding house, what it's come out to be.
Right.
And my wife and I went away for 2 days. When I came home, there was a car from one of the police sergeants over there wanting to see me at the police station, planning on harassing people. I took two pictures, and I explained it to him. I showed him it was on my phone. Well, now the owner of the property, last name Farkas, I guess he wants to pursue a claim I'm harassing people, and I'm not. So it's getting to the point, it's right up to here. I went to a meeting last Monday night in the village of South Bloomingdale. Same thing's going on over there, but worse. But worse. And if you don't clamp down on it, it's just going to get out of control here. We've been pleading for over a year now in our development. And there's been a little progress, but every time somebody's lawn, I got to pick a phone up and call somebody because the lawns aren't being cut. We got swimming pools now that are dark green, breeding mosquitoes. I got tired of taking pictures and sending them to the building inspector.
What does he say? I just out of curiosity.
Well, he wanted to know, did they clear it up the last time? I don't think he's got a filter. If he does,
you what?
Pool filter.
Go on my deck, stop at my house and look out on my deck and see what I look at. Absolutely horrible.
This is the guy to your right?
Guy to my right.
He's selling, right?
He's selling.
So he doesn't care.
And he doesn't cut his grass either. And I stopped. I used to come all the way over to his driveway and I gave up. It is what it is. But anyway, I just wanted to give you these from the village itself, Looney Rover, that you can use them or not. But what they wind up doing is when there's a property maintenance violation, they hold a public hearing. The village board holds a public hearing, and they give the violator the opportunity to come before them.
Right.
So there was two the other night, and neither one of them showed.
Mm-hmm.
So they wound up authorizing to have private landscaper go in and do the cutting of the grass.
do, and we've sent them out, you know, this thing that John's talking about is something that probably goes back a year ago, and I stepped into it early on, and I would have them down there constantly, the PD, and we actually nailed a couple of guys for the bus, we nailed a guy for the noise, we nailed a guy parking the wrong way, we nailed a guy for no tags, driving out of his driveway. What happened as a result of all that is two of my officers got called down there because they wanted to discuss harassment on them, and I got involved in that. And I explained that, in fact, that wasn't the case, that we have ordinances for noise, we have ordinances for protection of our children with regard to passing buses and parking in the right direction. There's all coverable enforcement there, and that we were in our right to do this. The fact that you took a car out with no tags and you drove out of the development, because when I came down, I saw no car. When I came back, the car came back. I knew it had been gone, and they had seen it. So this was all discoverable, but one of the issues is you can be told this, but unless he's there, sitting there, every time one of these infractions are going on, one of these violations, it's a he said, she said kind of environment. But to your point, we keep pushing and pushing to make sure that these people are involved with their quality of their home, their environment, and their neighbors. It's a challenge. One of the things that this board, as part of this property maintenance code, is going to establish is that lawn height. You know, I'm in favor of 6 inches, but keep in mind with 6 inches, that means everybody.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And that'll be only one piece. I mean, it'll be very comprehensive and it'll be very complete. And because
you know, I'm around retired, so I'm around. I'm driving all day, and I see a lot of.
Well, that's why I offered you the code enforcement job. For the record, public, I offered John Carl the public enforcement job on a part-time basis, and he declined it 3 times. But listen, nobody better than him, given his acute ability to find these infractions, I thought it would be a perfect fit. Anyway, I understand it, and I'm probably more frustrated than you are. Well, I asked Anthony to come tonight. I'm glad he's here. Thank you, Anthony. I appreciate that. And Bob Ferrara has come on a couple occasions. So, I mean, you know, and I get it. You know, a lot of people commute. A lot of people are retired. A lot of people got a lot going on. The last thing they want to come here is, you know, but it's important. I understand that.
They can submit. Can they submit email comments?
They could. And you don't have to. There is, to the point, they do have to submit in writing should they want to present the violation. I'm happy to sign them all. I don't think there's an error with that. I don't know. No, you may not, but there are a lot of people that do.
Just because he says it doesn't make it true. You know what I mean?
But, you know, my stepdaughter stayed at my house to watch my dog, and she gets a knock at the door at 8 o'clock at night. It's Monroe police. You know, where's John? She didn't want to tell me while we were on vacation, but it just took a couple nights to get the heck out of town. And when I came home, she said, oh, by the way, I got a shirt. She gave me the thing. She said, I got this the other night. I didn't want to tell you. I didn't want to ruin your vacation. So, but I'm a big boy. I understand how it works.
Well, I'm just making the point that should somebody want to relay it to me, I will physically see it, and I will go and write the violation. I have no problem doing that.
Thank you.
Any problem with that? So I'm good.
Mr. Metz?
Oh, I'm sorry, Andy.
Oh.
Just while we're on the property maintenance and abandoned vehicles and rewriting some of that, can we also be maybe proactive as far as I brought this up back last year with the parking of vehicles on walls, especially on some of the homes that are rentals where you have multiple tenants, only a 2-car driveway in some instances, some are 4-car driveways. Wasn't even crushed on, they did it
appreciate it. Yeah, United Hudson, I've spoken to him. Actually, I had him come here one day, and he came to the window. I don't know if you were over there. So I made him come into Village Hall, and I told him, your signs have got to stop. You can't keep still signs on your on these properties forever. You got 30 days, and they got to go away. And then you're adding multiple layers of signs now, too. He says, you can't do that. Then he tried to suggest maybe harassment, because he said, you don't like me, and I'm like, got nothing to do with that. It's got to do with code. It's got to do with quality of life, and it's got to do with people having peace. And this is not bringing peace. The intent here is to bring anxiety, and you're doing a great job of it. It's got to stop. That's the owner of United Hudson.
And then speaking of those signs, on Freeland Street, it's been up for about a week now, on the corner of Freeland and Foreshee. I think it's a Better Homes and Gardens sign, but it says on the top of it, coming soon. Doesn't say that it's for sale, it just says coming soon. It's got a real estate sign hanging down.
Yeah, that's at the corner of Franklin and Foreshee. And Freeland.
Oh, yeah. Really? Look at that. You're laughing. It says coming soon. They're advertising a real estate company with a sign that comes as coming soon.
Gotcha. Okay. And yes, Anthony, we'll just, I got all your stuff, and anything you want to add to it, by all means, send it to me.
Mr. Metz.
Good evening, everybody. Mr. Mayor, first, thank you for visiting us. Trustee Hall, thank you for visiting us last week, and I hope you enjoyed your visit there and stuff. Just a mention, just before you have your public hearing on this new law, the square footage and stuff,
mm-hmm.
I would address three issues that I would look at property charts for these properties that are in the SR10s and SR20s, only because I have experience, and no, not in the village, it's outside the village, so don't worry about it. A lot of them have cottages on them. So when you say 20,000 square feet, 5,400 square feet, and you use the word modified homes, does that imply what happens if the house burns down? What if they're just rebuilding it? There's all sorts of mechanisms that a homeowner, because a lot of the properties are also up for sale now in the village, a number of them, what happens when the building burns down? You got three buildings on a piece of property, in fact, on High Street. If those buildings burn down, can the guy rebuild as they were? Or does he have to go buy your SR10, whatever.
Right.
So he loses value, which means now the village is going to lose estate, the taxes, real estate, because they're going to go to the village board to April and say, listen, I had a 10,000 square foot house there. I can only build 54. What's your new tax base? You're maxing it out at 54. God willing, nothing ever happens in Rest Haven. We know, it's 9,300 square foot house. But this would limit me only to rebuilding to 54, assuming what the modified means, even if it caught on fire. You know what I'm saying? So consider that when you're doing it, that the definition of modified. Second thing is consider the properties that do have existing cottages on it, which actually makes it affordable. Because I've got seven out on Lakes Road on one property, and I'll tell you, I get $1,200 a month. My tenants usually stay 3 to 5. I got one there 30 years, I've got another one there 10 plus years. It's affordable. And we know Monroe is hard to live in, but when an owner like myself has multiple buildings on one lot, we tend to make a little more money, but we can say the rent can be lower. I'm covering my costs and walk to a little chit-chat in my pocket, Just so you know that. The other thing I would suggest is you cap it at 20,000 square feet. There's lots of properties in the village here that are, pretty much with acreage. And you might want to think about that as we get to the next board meeting and think about how do you handle those situations. Because even my friend across the street, she's got 3.1 acres. Her house is 7,000 square feet. What happens when something happens there? She's Dr. Topman's house. That doesn't fit into the square footage. That burned down. So you get just some food for thought and you think about all that as you're putting it together next week. And of course, I'll be here to listen. I have never had nothing to say. With good news, Mr. Mayor, on another note, I want to hand this to you. The book came out. Rest Haven is in the book, and it's a nationally sold book on Amazon.com. Rest Haven in it.
That's awesome.
What's the name of the book?
Hidden Treasures of the Hudson Valley.
Volume 3 by Anthony P. Musso. And it just came out a couple weeks ago. You'll see it there.
Can I leave it here for the village?
Actually, the village may have it. It's an extra copy I purchased for the village to have. I did turn one over to the town historian as well. So Jim Nelson has a copy of it as well. So
very nice to see you, Tim.
Another success that we're heading towards. So I figured I hope to see you guys all in October. And I thank you for your meeting with you again.
And I think you got Rave, right?
Huh?
You had Rave music? Rave, the guy I gave you? Playing musician?
When?
Did you hire a musician?
Oh, no, we haven't reached him yet. We're still trying to reach out to him.
Oh, somebody told me he was hired for something here.
No, I haven't reached out to him.
Oh, okay.
No, sorry, I think they may have reached out to him or Pam got the number. I don't know. I'm lost in this whole thing right now.
Okay, well, somebody told me that you hired him for the date. I don't know who that was.
Yeah.
What's the date in October?
October 13th. As I explained to the mayor, the way the program's working that day is starting at 11 a.m. We will be, hopefully, we're just waiting on the final permit on everything, but we've been assured the date is safe. We will be using the high school auditorium from 11 to 12:30, which would be a presentation on the history of Rest Haven, as well as the speakers of the American Foundation for the Blind, sitting president, Kurt Adams, William Krettinger, who is the New York State gentleman from the Park Service that evaluated us. He'll be speaking that day, and I promise you I will definitely be speaking that day. And so that's basically where we are, and we have some videos and stuff going on. Then what we're doing from there is there'll be an introductory to the movie The Miracle Worker by a lady named Pamela from Pamela's on the Hudson in Newburgh. Reason she is being the one to do it, she is the 19-month-old baby in that movie. And we have obtained the original article, believe it or not, from July 11, 1961, talking about her role in this thing. And this is when she lived in New York City. And her mother and her attended the release of the documentary last year. From there, we will then go into playing the movie. However, only a group of people who are invited privately to control the, you know, traffic and stuff at the house will come back to the house. There will be a ribbon cutting official. Obviously, the entire board is invited, especially you. No, I'm kidding.
Oh, thanks.
You're welcome. So the entire board will be invited. We're going to be inviting the town of Monroe, the entire board for the town of Monroe. We're going to be going all the way up the food chain in the county. Politicians are being there. I'm hoping that the county, again, passes a resolution recognizing the Blindness Awareness Month for October. As I've spoken with the mayor about possibly doing with the village as well, because I want to put our best suit on, best dress on for the our guests that are coming to town. They've asked me already what type of future I want with them and what I'd like to do with them, and I told them we would speak about that. In fact, I have a conversation with them tomorrow over the date, and they're inviting not only the current sitting president coming, who's actually blind and runs the organization with the assistance of his wife, will be also their archivist, Helen Selden, and one of their business managers will be there, as well as private invitations to their current city and prior trustees, local contributors within, I think it's a 100-mile radius, and they're also, because I don't have this type of clout, although I wish I would, they're asking the two grandchildren that we're aware of Mr. Miguel, to be here as well, to attend the event as well. So what you will have that day, Mr. Lance unfortunately passed, what you will have that day is the American Foundation for the Blind here, who basically operated from 23 to 68. You will have Mrs. Lance here, who will be staying at the house with her daughter Karen. They owned it from 1968 to 1986,
and you will also have a former CEO and president of ARC, who will also be there, who's actually the gentleman that signed the contract and sold us the property. So you're going to have almost 100 years worth of people that had involvement with this house. And that's hard to find today. It's a miracle that we found. But I think you'll be very pleasantly surprised when this thing is done. And we can maybe push them to come here and do more in the community, because I think it fits the community. I think it fits what goes on with NW Cares at the high school. And I think you'll find it quite interesting, the whole project, what we're going to be doing there. So I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay.
School's tomorrow, so everybody be safe. If you have kids, get into the bus on time. Otherwise, they get left behind.
Make a motion and we go into executive session for the purposes of attorney-client and land acquisition.
I make a motion that we go into executive session to for the purpose of attorney-client and land acquisition.
A second.
A third.
Call the question?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, so Carrie, thank you very much for coming.